President Gerald Ford pressed his election efforts on a two-day West Coast trip. Before arriving in Sacramento, he added friends and money to the Republican cause in Seattle and Portland. In the capital city of California, he told its business leaders to create more jobs. It was a short walk from the hotel to the legislative chambers to urge the lawmakers to cooperate in a tough anti-crime program. Suddenly, a hand came from the crowd, pointing a gun at the President of the United States, an assassination attempt that brought some frightening moments on the day the President came to town.
The day the President came to town is a presentation of KCRA News. And now for KCRA News, here is Bob Whitten.
Friday, September the 5th, nearly became a day of tragedy in the history of this country. A young woman pointed a gun at point-blank range at President Gerald Ford as he walked through a large crowd of well-wishers on his way to a Capitol appearance. Joining me now is KCRA's Capitol correspondent, Otis Turner.
The President spent 16 hours in Sacramento today meeting with government officials and business leaders. He also wanted to meet the people. But President Ford's fondness for pressing the flesh almost cost him his life. KCRA's Steve Swat followed the president from early morning to mid-afternoon, and he was present during that tense moment.
Everywhere the president went today, he was surrounded by law enforcement, agents on rooftops near the convention center, at the Senator Hotel, near the Capitol. There had been previous threats against the president's life in Dallas, in New York City, and last month, a man was arrested in Sacramento for threatening to kill the president. An ambulance was always close by in case of emergency. But the president likes meeting the people, shaking hands with well-wishers. So he walked the few hundred yards from the Senator Hotel to the Capitol.
Thank you. All right, let him go on by.
Hey. Seconds later, the president, in a jovial mood, passed a young woman who was wearing a red dress and walked another 2 or 3 feet. Then she thrust a hand through the crowd, a hand holding a loaded 45 caliber pistol. A Secret Service agent grabbed the gun, grabbed the woman, as six other agents forced the president to double up for protection. Then they hustled him at a trot the final 100 yards through the Capitol doors to the governor's office. The suspect, the woman charged with trying to kill the president, is Lynette Fromm, a disciple of convicted killer Charles Manson. She was whisked into a Sacramento police car for booking.
And all of a sudden, I was standing maybe 3 feet from Ford, about behind two people. All of a sudden, I saw the Secret Service man right behind Ford just reach in and just reach out and push. And I saw this woman start to go down and her arm go back, and I saw the gun. And I didn't watch what Ford was doing, and they wrestled her to the ground and were slapping cuffs on her. And a big black gun, they got it out of her hand, and she kept saying, easy fellas, it didn't go off, it didn't go off.
I was standing about 10 feet down the line from him. He had just shook my hand and kept on going, and then all of a sudden the Secret Service men rushed out from behind him and grabbed this gal in this red, long, flowing gown. And as they put the arm around her, the 45, it looked like a 45, dropped to the ground. And then the crowd got everybody away from that area, pushed them back, and the 45 just laid there.
What was she saying?
When they got her tied behind this tree, she kept saying that he's not a public servant. He's not a public servant.
The president, right after it happened, turned around and kind of looked back at the spot. And it was clear, to me at least, that he was aware of what had happened. He seemed to me stunned, bewildered, dazed, something like that. And it was clear that he knew what had happened. And
the head of the White House.
20 minutes later, Presidential Press Secretary Ron Nessen emerged from the governor's office with word that the president was not hurt.
Ron, how would you describe the president taking the situation, and is he going to continue his schedule?
The president will continue on and finish his schedule today.
How is he taking the situation? Could you describe it?
He essentially had no comment about it.
Until this point, Lynette Fromm had not been identified as the woman involved. Nessen, after conferring with the police, then made it official.
When he saw the gun, did he leap out of the way?
Agent Boondorf turned over the woman to Agent McCarter, and then returned to his duties of protecting the president. Later, it was established that the gun was a 45 and was loaded. Agent Boondorf was treated by the president's physician, Dr. William Lukash. The only treatment required was a Band-Aid on the cut. The woman was identified by the Sacramento City Police Department as Lynn Alice Frome.
Steve, it wasn't until Mr. Nesson's remarks that we got what happened. Those first minutes must have been extremely confusing, and you were right there on the scene.
Well, cameraman Ed Ray and I were about 5 feet to the left of the president, a little behind him, and it was very confusing because I did see the president, what I thought, drop down to his knees. I thought he had stumbled or had slipped. And then in all the confusion, the president was really whisked away, and we were trying to catch up to the president, and I remember looking down to the ground to see if the ground was wet, because I really did think he had slipped. Mm-hmm. And then you'd hear a few statements that, I think someone pulled a gun. But no one was really sure, in the press party anyway, I think, until about 20 minutes later, until we had interviewed some of the eyewitnesses.
Mm-hmm. What was the gun was a 45 automatic?
Semi-automatic, and it had four bullets in the clip, but it did not have a bullet in the chamber, so that if it was fired, it would not have shot anything.
If she'd have pulled the trigger, there wasn't anything in the chamber to go off.
But it was loaded.
Yeah. Seems funny to attempt to take someone's life, but not to have the round in the chamber. Perhaps she didn't know how to use it.
No one knows the answer to that as yet. I understand that you found out she had talked to a police officer earlier.
That's right. About 5 minutes before the president had left the Senator Hotel, a woman identified as Lynette Fromm had talked to a Sacramento police officer, and she asked him, is this the route the president is going to take? And the police officer was fairly evasive and did not really give a straight answer, for security reasons, of course. But there was a huge crowd of several hundred people, about five deep, lining the walkway up to the east steps of the Capitol, and Ms. Fromm stayed with the crowd.
So a 27-year-old woman by the name of Lynn Alice Fromm pulled a gun today. We'll find out more about this woman from one of our reporters who has talked to her in just a moment. Lynn Fromm is the woman who is accused with attempting to shoot the President of the United States in Sacramento today. This person that tried to become another Lee Harvey Oswald, or Sirhan Sirhan, or James Earl Ray. KCRA's Mary Murphy had an occasion several months ago to get rather involved with her and some of the members of the Manson family. Mary, tell us a little bit about this woman.
Well, first, Bob, I'd like to give you just a little bit of background information on the woman. 27-year-old Lynette Alice Frome was nicknamed Squeaky because of her high-pitched voice. She was one of the earliest Manson family members and the head of the family after Manson was jailed. At his trial, the thin, freckled redhead said she joined Manson at the age of 16 after her father, quote, kicked her out of the house, and Manson found her crying on a street corner in Venice, California. She came of a fairly well-to-do family, her father an aeronautical engineer in Santa Monica. She attended junior college in Torrance for a short time and then dropped out. Like other Manson girls, Lynette Frome was extremely antagonistic toward her family. And in Charlie, she thought she had found her savior. At his trial, she said Manson once hit her so hard he knocked her clear across the room. But she said, it was just what I needed. Though not directly connected with the Tate-LaBianca murders, Lynette Frome was twice arrested for murder, but both times those charges were dropped. We had an opportunity to meet Lynette Frome and her roommate, Sandra Good, in their apartment in downtown Sacramento. And if you recall, we didn't get a chance to film them. They wouldn't be filmed at that time, but we did talk to them for an hour or so.
Were they doing in Sacramento? Why were they here?
They said they had moved here to be closer to Charles Manson, who was then at Folsom. Even though they couldn't communicate with him, somehow there was some kind of a mystical connection there. If they could be closer to him, just in distance, that it would be better for Charlie. And they wanted to be closer to the center of political power in California. They said they wanted to meet Governor Brown and Attorney General Evel Younger, and they had ideas on how the state should be run.
I believe she even met at one time with Mervyn Dimeley in carrying her quest to see Manson. And it wasn't until she got in the office there that Lieutenant Governor found out who she was. She claimed to be the wife of Charles Manson. What kind of apartment did they live in? What did it look like?
It's a very modest apartment. I think they said they paid about $85 a month rent. It was furnished mostly with books, very plain furnishings. They did have a television set, and they did have a stereo, which interested me. They also had a picture of Charles Manson hung almost like an image, like an idol, a religious thing hung over their window, their bay window. They had a lot of grains and herbs and teas around. They were very interested in natural foods, and in cultivating them, they gathered a lot of things themselves. But actually, it was a very plain place, nothing fancy.
Do you know how they supported themselves?
I asked them that several times. I kept trying to get back to this idea of where does your money come from, and they kept saying they were outside of the money system. And I kept saying, well, who pays your rent? And the arguments would go round and round, and finally, they started in telling me about how they would gather things out of garbage cans and how they always would find things on the street when they needed them. Food was somehow provided. Things were provided. They didn't really have to go looking for things because Providence was taking care of them.
When you were in their apartment, did you see any weapons at all or any political statements of any kind, material pamphlets, that kind of thing?
No weapons, but they were really very politically aware, which surprised me. And there were a lot of underground literature on how this country is being run, who's running it, a lot of conspiracy theories. And they would bring out pamphlets from time to time to show me, but no weapons. And
well, what seemed to be the aim of their philosophy? Were they aimed towards political reform, ecology, or what?
Mainly, their main idea in life is to get Charles Manson out of jail. And in an interview we'll see later, you can hear Sandra Good talking about what she thinks Charles Manson can do for this country. Their whole life revolved around Charlie. And she actually thinks that Charlie could be president of this country and run it better than the present political leaders.
You know, many people have asked the question, why wasn't Lynn Frohm under observation by the Secret Service? Why didn't they know where she was, and why didn't they keep a closer eye on her? Actually, as you mentioned, Mary, she'd been critical of President Ford, a devoted follower of Charles Manson. The President's news secretary, Ron Nesson, said that Ms. Frohm was not known to the Secret Service to be a threat to the President, a fact which astonished some, including the chief prosecutor of the Manson case, Vincent Bugliosi.
During the trial, she and Manson and several other members of the family expressed open hostility, as you probably well know, towards President Nixon. And President Ford, being the appointee of President Nixon, it's understandable to me that in their minds, he should also be the object of their hatred. I find it absolutely incredible and inexcusable that someone of Lynn Squeaky Fromm's past history and her reputation would be permitted to get within 2 feet of President Ford. Law enforcement does not deserve any credit for the fact that President Ford is still alive. It seems to me that they should have been watching Squeaky throughout the years, as I don't think they've done. And when President Ford was scheduled to come to Sacramento, law enforcement should have contacted the Secret Service and alerted them about the existence of this person, and perhaps this would never have happened.
The man Bugliosi put in prison, Charles Manson, is in San Quentin prison tonight, serving a life term for murder. Manson learned of the attempt on President Ford's life today by the prison grapevine. A San Quentin prison official said Manson reacted with what seemed to be noncommittal surprise. Ms. Frohm had made several applications to visit the 40-year-old Manson, but the two have not communicated since the 1969 trial, which effectively broke up the group known as the Manson family.
Charles Manson was convicted in 1971 of murder and conspiracy to commit murder, even though the prosecution never accused him of physically committing any murders by his own hand. The killing was done by Manson's devoted followers, young people, mostly girls, who lived with him in various communal arrangements, the most famous of which was the so-called Spawn Movie Ranch, where they all were living when the murders of actress Sharon Tate and six other persons took place. Squeaky Fromm was one of those residents.
I had a knife, but it was for eating. You know, I cut things with it, and I poked honey cans and stuff like that.
What about people running around naked out there?
Well, I took off my clothes whenever I got a chance. It was hot.
Manson's entourage was called a family, and it had deep, mystical, mostly incomprehensible overtones. The girls, who were co-defendants, gouged crosses in their foreheads as signs of their devotion to Manson. The testimony described the vicious, ritualistic killing of the apparently random victims, without ever adequately explaining why they were killed. Lynette Squeaky Fromm and Sandra Good, who also was picked up today in Sacramento, became the self-appointed outside spokesman for Manson, holding impromptu press conferences when the trial was in recess, reading statements, something they've continued to do ever since Manson went to prison. In recent months, several news organizations have received messages purporting to come from them, including KNBC in Los Angeles. This letter said, among other things, that unless Manson were given a chance to explain his mystic truth, there will be many more young murderers, beginning with the person typing this letter. At the height of Manson's trial, when his head was shaved, Squeaky Fromm, Sandra Good, and the other faithful girls shaved their heads, dug crosses in their brows, and swore they would carry on Manson's ideals. Frank Burkholzer, NBC News, Los Angeles.
Just moments after Lynn Fromm's arrest on the Capitol grounds in Sacramento, KCRA's Mary Murphy and cameraman Alex Calloway drove over to the Sacramento apartment that Lynn Fromm shares with another Manson family member, Sandra Good. Here's Mary again.
When we arrived at the apartment on P Street, just a few blocks from the Capitol, everything was quiet. A few minutes later, half a dozen plainclothes officers from the Sacramento Police Department showed up and surrounded the house. The armed officers entered the downtown apartment that the two Manson girls have shared for close to a year. About 20 minutes later, officers brought out Sandra Good, a Manson family member, and another woman, Kathleen Murphy. Both were taken in for questioning on the theory the assassination attempt may have been a conspiracy. But several hours later, authorities released the two women, apparently satisfied that they were not involved. Sandra Good returned to her apartment and answered reporters' questions.
What's going to happen now?
Yeah, they're inside now, is that it?
Unless Manson gets a court rule and is allowed to speak, the country will be bloodier than the Tate Law Bianca House has put together. You people need somebody to help you with your problems.
Then she talked about Lynette Fromm's character, but frequently returned to the subject of Manson.
She has more concern for your children, all of you, than you yourselves
do. You think she knew what she was doing today?
Of course she knew what she was doing. She was moved to do what she did, and you'll have to talk to her to find out why. I can't speak for her. I know that we're very, very sensitive to what's going on in this country right now, and we see that there's no leadership, there's nobody that the people can trust or put faith in. You must let Manson up. When it starts getting crazy, when the money won't spend, you better let him up. You're gonna need him.
And so spoke that young lady this afternoon to Mary Murphy and other reporters. Justice moved rather quickly today. There was an arraignment for Fromm. We'll have that aspect after this. At this hour, President Ford is safely back home in Washington, D.C. His would-be assassin is in the Sacramento County Jail and faces a maximum penalty of life in prison.
27-year-old Lynette Squeaky Fromm was whisked into federal court around 3 this afternoon. Four cars accompanied her from the county jail. Miss Fromm was seated between two matrons in the back seat of the second car. Security was tight. One U.S. Marshal was quoted saying they didn't want another Oswald situation. Soon after arriving, she was ushered into a tiny hearing room, surrounded by some 20 or so local and federal officers. U.S. Magistrate Esther Mix read the charge. Miss Fromm was accused of knowingly and willfully attempting to assassinate the President of the United States. Bail was set at $1 million. A description of the gun was read into the record, a .45 caliber pistol. The barrel chamber was empty, but there were 4 live rounds in the gun clip. Statements by Secret Service agents were also read. They said, as she was wrestled to the ground, Miss Fromm shouted, "It didn't go off. Can you believe it? It didn't go off." At a press conference later, Douglas Duncan, special agent in charge, talked about why Lynette Fromm, a known Manson family member, was not under surveillance.
I wasn't personally aware, although our office is from time to time known that these people have been in Sacramento, purely as an intelligence relation between other agencies, and that they have created some disturbance because of their relationship with this prisoner Charles Manson.
Why were they not under surveillance, sir? You started.
Because they have never expressed any interest in the president or anything of a federal nature.
Were you aware
that we can't surveil or make that type of an investigation on every person that is a little bit out of the ordinary as far as any cause that they might espouse?
From the time the president landed in Sacramento, he had an extremely tight schedule, and even despite the incident that occurred on the Capitol steps, he didn't seem to miss one part of it. He kept right on going.
Bob, witnesses said that the president was stunned and bewildered by the attempt on his life. I think that's understandable, but he was fully composed after leaving the Capitol and returning to the Senator Hotel. President Ford praised the Secret Service and emphasized he will not alter his practice of meeting the people during his travels.
I think the Secret Service and the other law enforcement agencies that were on the job were doing a superb job, and I want to thank them for everything they did in this unfortunate incident. I also wish to express to the people of California my gratitude for the very, very warm welcome that they've given me in the state of California, and I would not under any circumstances feel that one individual in any way represented the attitude on the part of the people of California. I just thank the Californians for being so friendly and so hospitable. And let me add with great emphasis, this incident, under no circumstances, will prevent me or preclude me from contacting the American people as I travel from one state to another and from one community to another. In my judgment, it's vitally important for a president to see the American people. And I'm going to continue to have that personal contact and relationship with the American people. I think it's vital, and I intend to carry it on.
President, can you give us an idea of what you saw or felt personally?
I am not sure that I ought to describe what I saw beyond the fact that I saw a hand coming up behind several others in the front row. And obviously there was a gun in that hand. I then saw almost instantaneously very quick and very effective action by the Secret Service in taking care of the matter.
The only slight alteration to the president's statement about meeting the people during his travels would have been when he left Sacramento McClellan Air Force Base. There had been plans made that he would come out there. There were about 6,000-7,000 people, and that he would have stopped and walked down the line and shaked hands with a few of them.
But I'm sure there were many who were disappointed by that, but I'm also sure that he could well understand why he would want to get out of the car and get on that plane as quickly as he could.
Yeah.
Steve, you spent more time with the president today than any of us. Following the event in Capitol Park, could you discern any change in his schedule or the security around him?
Only a minor change. He immediately met with Governor Brown, and I'm told it only came up, the incident only came up at the very end of the meeting. He met with legislative leaders, and I'm told by Ron Nessen that the incident did not come up at all. He gave his speech to the joint session of the legislature. He took some pictures with some local Republicans at the Capitol for campaign purposes. And then he was supposed to walk back to the Senator Hotel from the Capitol, the same way he walked in from the east side. He did not. He took his bulletproof limousine back. And I think there was a sigh of relief when that happened, really for all concerned, because although President Ford does like to meet people, does like to shake hands, press the flesh, as you said, certainly they weren't taking any more chances after this incident.
The Secret Service try to convince him not to get close to the public?
I really don't know. I didn't talk to any Secret Service people. From what I understand, the president does like to get close to the public, and the Secret Service was a little uptight and concerned, and they admitted that. They said it's been a rough day, and we don't want to take any more chances.
One thing I noticed on the floor of the State Assembly, I've seen the Secret Service, as all of us have, I guess, at one time or another, operating in much of the time they seem to just sort of fade into the background. If you don't know, they're really not obvious. But this time, today, they were very obvious, standing up there right down front, and it was very obvious that they were keeping a close watch on
and
them.
And not only the Secret Service, there were state police, Sacramento City Police, Sacramento Sheriff's deputies, I think auxiliary forces. I mean, people were all over, and they all had the badges or the uniforms, and he was completely surrounded at all times, really.
Beyond all of that, I've noticed after covering presidents that these Secret Service men in this administration are much more relaxed and treat the media with a different kind of attitude than those worked for Nixon or Johnson or Kennedy. And they admit themselves there's a whole new air in Washington about the way they're supposed to react.
But immediately after the attempt on the president's life, there was a complete change in the attitude of the police, and for obvious reasons, toward the press. It was just hold that crowd back, keep that crowd back. I mean, very difficult to get film, and shoving and pushing and trying to keep us back, and with good reason.
One reporter was knocked down. The Secret Service man picked him up and said, excuse me.
Well, that also happened to our cameraman, Ed Ray, when we were trying to catch up to the president. He slipped on the steps of the east side of the Capitol, and a Secret Service man picked him up underneath the arms, just lifted him off the ground and set him back on his 2 feet. And Ed went whisking in through the east side of the Capitol right after the president did.
Mary Murphy's job today was not to get involved in this as much as she had. Her real assignment was to cover a peace rally. There had been stories that came into our newsroom about planned demonstrations for the president and some crazy crank calls, which we won't even talk about. But what was the peace rally today?
That was really kind of amusing, Bob, because we started out on the east steps, or on the west steps, excuse me, of the Capitol to cover this peace rally, and there were two people there. So we quickly decided that at least at that point there wasn't a rally, and we had time to look around, see what was happening, and come back. So we just wandered around to the west steps of the Capitol, and we weren't there 5 minutes when all the president came out and everything just broke loose. So we really didn't do the story we were supposed to.
Yeah. What was it like as soon as it happened? There were a lot of people, a lot of reporters around the president also. Was there panic or just general confusion?
I think my reaction was that it was amazing how calm it was. People, it was very calm. It was almost as if nothing major had happened. You couldn't believe that an attempt had been made on the president's life because you thought, surely, you know, the sky must fall or something. It was just very calm.
I think only a few people right in that general area where this happened knew what had happened, and almost everyone else thought, some commotion, but no big problem. Perhaps the president had stumbled or slipped. And a Secret Service agent right then at the time yelled, "Let's go," which apparently is a code word or a trigger word for the Secret Service. That means we have something serious here. Let's get out of here fast. And they did.
It would be totally impossible to guard any and all people that are considered even slight threats to a man as important as the president of our United States.
And especially a president who feels obligated to go out and meet people. He doesn't want to sit behind a bulletproof vest the whole time. He wants to go out and mix it up.
Well, of course, the president had some other things to do while he was in Sacramento. KCRA's Bill Harvey covered part of that story. We'll talk to him in just a moment. In the aftermath of the attempt on the life of President Ford, the purpose of his visit to Sacramento and what he had to say to businessmen, civic leaders, and legislators has almost been forgotten. The President's day started very early with a speech to the annual host breakfast of the State Chamber of Commerce. Here's KCRA's Bill Harvey. Bill?
Robert, as you know, that State Chamber host breakfast traditionally has been held in recent years in a Sacramento hotel, but it was moved this year to the mammoth new Sacramento Community Center because of the tremendous demand for tickets from business and civic leaders throughout the state to hear the president. A record 1,200 of the state and city's most influential people were on hand this morning to give Mr. Ford a very warm welcome. And most of them were highly receptive to his oft-repeated call in recent weeks for the unshackling of the free enterprise system to provide the 11 million new jobs that will be needed by 1980 through a cutback and reform of the federal regulatory bureaucracy. Here is the edited essence of what he had to say.
In recent years, a disproportionate percentage of new jobs has come from the public sector rather than the private. The result has been the creation of a bureaucracy that contributes very little to America's prosperity and productivity, it simply shares it. Starting from point zero, about a century ago, the federal government now employs over 100,000 people whose sole responsibility is writing, reviewing, and enforcing some type of regulation. 100,000 people whose principal job is telling you how to do your job. It's a bureaucrat's dream of heaven, but it's a nightmare for those who have to bear the heavy burden. Just to list all of the rules and regulations established last year required 45,000 pages of very small type in the Federal Register. I mourn for the trees that were felled in America's forests to make this exercise in governmental nagging possible. Regulatory reform legislation I propose will seek to eliminate the obsolete, the unnecessary, the impractical, and yes, the impossible. Let's retain what is truly helpful and required in federal regulations. It's a minimum amount. Let's get rid of the rest, and the sooner the better. If the United States is to grow in a substantial, meaningful way, the impetus has to come from the private sector. Jobs are the symbol of a healthy free enterprise system. Jobs, particularly in the private sector, are the fuel that makes our economy run. Obviously, to achieve the full economic potential of America and Americans, we must make it possible for our industry to maintain its competitive edge in world as well as domestic trade. We have no choice but to compete, and I say with emphasis, to excel. Help me, help your representatives in the Congress, help your governor, help your state legislature. Help us all to free the free American enterprise system. Give America the means, and the Americans will find the way. Thank you very much.
Following his appeal for support for regulatory agency reform, the president left almost immediately to return to his hotel for a change of clothes before meeting with Governor Brown and addressing the legislature. And that was the situation which set the stage for his walk to the Capitol and the dramatic assassination attempt, which we've already reported on in detail.
Bill, those attending the host breakfast represented what would be a list of the corporate giants of California, Bank of America, Southern Pacific, Del Monte Foods, on and on.
They even had the Russian Consul General in San Francisco there.
Well, did you get a chance to talk with him? What was the reaction of the audience to the president's speech?
I didn't get a chance to talk with the Russian Consul General, but you've got to understand the audience, of course, was heavily sympathetic to the president's philosophic point of view, and as you'd expect, their reaction would be largely favorable, and it was that, but we do have a sampling that we took from some of the foremost businessmen in the state.
Well, I thought the president's comments were very, very timely. Of course, we're all proud to have him here in Sacramento and at the host breakfast, but he properly talked about the excessive government regulation, which is a burden on our economy. He talked about the need of getting America back to work. He said that the private sector was the best mechanism that we have in the country to do that, and certainly I agree with that, and I think that the audience agreed heartily, as indicated by their applause. I think the president is on the right track and support him 100% in these efforts.
Well, I think the president gave a very determined statement in which he stated that we're either going to become free Americans again and cause our economy to grow, or we're going to go further and further in the direction of a planned socialistic type economy. I just came back from Canada yesterday and to see rates of inflation there approaching 25% in the province of British Columbia and the tyranny that's creating in that area. gives me great concern for our own future if we don't turn our country around and let investment forces get into position again in order that we can create new jobs, improve the productivity of the country, and stop this never-ending hijacking, if I may call it that, of wage increases, which are only based on force and not upon the fact that we have created a bigger productivity pie to share amongst all the people in our country.
Well, the president, of course, had a very receptive audience for the things that he had to say, and he's been saying a number of things that Governor Brown has been saying, too. The hopeful thing is that the message gets over to the legislators here in California and the members of Congress back there, as the president is, that we require some action on the part of government to remove some of the barriers that the president talked about.
Incidentally, I talked to each of those three gentlemen also about the problem that the Ford visit to California might pose to the launching of a Reagan challenge to the Ford candidacy, and each of these three gentlemen answered to the effect that they couldn't see any basis for a viable Reagan challenge to Ford under any circumstances, which is an interesting comment, which...
In other words, you couldn't find Reagan supporters there among them.
Well, there were Reagan supporters, but as they put it, if a party has a candidate who is doing a job, there's no way you can disown that candidate and put in another candidate and expect to win an election.
Thank you, Bill. While the president was on the West Coast, he gave 7 or 8 addresses, speeches, and perhaps the most interesting one, if certainly not an ironic one, was the one that he gave before the legislature, a joint session in Sacramento. We'll be back with that story after this.
President Ford also addressed the California legislature today, calling for what he termed a citizens' coalition against crime. Having just escaped an assassination attempt, the president urged mandatory prison terms for criminals using dangerous weapons. It was the first time a president has addressed a joint session of the legislature. Joining lawmakers in the assembly chamber were Governor Brown, the other constitutional officers, and the justices of the state Supreme Court. President Ford read calmly from a prepared text, making no mention of the attempt on his life. But he said there has been an alarming increase in violent crime. He said far too many violent and repetitive criminals never spend a day in prison after conviction. The president called for mandatory sentencing of anyone committing a crime with a dangerous weapon.
The process should be ignored or the legal rights of defendants be reduced. I am not urging a vindictive attitude toward convicted offenders. I am saying that, as a matter of public policy, the time has come to give equal weight on the scale of justice to the rights of the innocent victims of crimes of terror and violence. If most serious crimes are committed by repeaters, most violent crimes by criminals carrying guns, if the tiny minority of habitual lawbreakers can be identified by modern data-keeping methods, then is it not mandatory that such offenders, duly tried and convicted, be removed from society for a definite period of time, rather than returning to the streets to continue to prey on the innocent and the law-abiding majority? Mandatory sentences need not be severe. It is the certainty of confinement that is presently lacking. We will never deter crime nor reduce its growth if potential lawbreakers feel they have favorable odds of escaping punishment. The more experience in crime they get, the better their odds of not suffering the consequences. That is wrong, and it must be reversed, and the quicker the better. The drug problem in America could make several speeches by itself.
Here again, we have a very small number of deliberate criminals who destroy the domestic tranquility of millions and millions of decent citizens. What is particularly outrageous is the tragedy they bring to young people who should be learning to face life, not run from it. Here in California, according to the latest figures I've seen, less than one out of every five convicted hard drug pushers ever served time in prison. One way to keep a convicted murderer from killing anybody else, and one way to keep a hard drug pusher from ruining any more lives, is to lock them up for a reasonable but certain term of imprisonment. Loss of liberty is both a deterrent to crime and a prevention of repeated crime, at least while the offender is behind bars. Prisoners should be treated humanely, and we cannot expect judges, Mr. Chief Justice, and juries to convict and sentence the guilty to places of confinement or that are cruel and degrading. But I consider it essential that we reduce delay in bringing arrested persons to trial, sharply limit the prevailing practice of plea bargaining caused by congested prosecutor and court calendars, and significantly increase the proportion of those convicted of violent crimes and repeated crimes who actually serve time in prison. If we fail to ensure domestic tranquility, any other successes we may have as public officials will be forgotten. Peace on 10th Street in Sacramento is as important to the people who walk and work there as peace in the Sinai Desert. One man or woman or child becomes just as dead from a switchblade slash as from a nuclear missile blast. We must prevent both. Thank you very much.
President Ford's speech lasted for about 25 minutes. It was interrupted 6 times by polite applause. His remarks were prepared in advance of the attempt on his life, but that incident added a note of urgency to his call for swift and certain punishment of violent criminals.
The legislature in California, Otis, has been trying to or attempt to deal with the problems brought up by the president in his speech, hasn't it?
Yes, the assembly just last week, as a matter of fact, sent Governor Brown a bill that would impose mandatory sentences on persons who commit certain types of serious crimes, kidnapping and so forth, with a dangerous weapon. The president also, as you noted, called for mandatory prison sentences for dealers in hard narcotics, heroin and so forth. A bill that was addressed to that problem was recently defeated. But the first bill, use of handguns, is now on the governor's desk. He has not indicated whether he will sign it.
Following his legislative address, the president returned to the Senator Hotel for a few more meetings. He spoke to state Republican leaders, the Attorney General Evel Younger, and taped a TV interview. At about 2:30 this afternoon, Mr. Ford left the hotel and headed for McClellan Air Force Base and a 4.5-hour flight that would take him back to the White House.
Okay, they're entering the main base operational area. It's where most of the crowd appears to have gathered. The Highway Patrol motorcycles in front. All decked out in their finery. There's the president and the Highway Patrol car moving out in front. The crowd waves as the president goes by. He's in there by himself, smiling and waving, his Secret Service men behind him. Members of the White House press corps, president's automobile is going to go all the way around the bank of Air Force One. The big limousine pulling to a halt right in front of the ramp. Yeah, there he goes. They obviously were successful. They fired up one of the engines. I don't know, Roy. They didn't like last night, early this morning, when he would go over to the crowds. They didn't seem to like that either. There he is, smiling, waving, clasping his hands. I can't see the gold cufflinks. Maybe I can't tell if he's wearing them or not. They were given to him by the host breakfast this morning. And there he is. He's aboard Air Force One. And behind him, members of his staff. There's Ron Nesson going up. Glasses, a briefcase in his right hand. A few more members, and that's about it.